Yeah, I wanted to start out with a story after my first space flight was in 1993, and my then 8-year-old daughter, we were riding in the car together, and I was thinking I was pretty cool because I'm an astronaut, I just flew in space, she must be really proud of me. And any parrot heads in the crowd? Any Jimmy Buffett fans?
Oh yeah.
A few? Okay. Well, we're listening to Jimmy Buffett on the radio in the car, and all of a sudden my daughter goes, "You know, Dad, you'd really be famous if you were a singer." So, whatever, okay, I can't sing, but it's great to be back in this area. It's a beautiful part of the country. I went for a run in my old neighborhood, went by the old house and by the old creek and by African Road there. Now I guess it's called Vestal Middle School, and then African Road Elementary. But it's great to be back in this area. My heart goes out to all of you who suffered in the flood last year. As many of you know, I was supposed to come last summer, but because of yet another flood that they had in this area, I know it was devastating to many of, probably affected many of you here. But my heart goes out to you, and hopefully things are getting better in that aspect. But it's great. It's great to be back. Incidentally, that 8-year-old daughter who said I'd really be famous if I was a singer, she just had, she's now 27 and just had my first grandson 3 days ago. So now I'm a grandfather. And I must say I'm much prouder of that than flying in space. So, you know, our children, they represent our future. We see our future sitting right here today. And that's really what I think our space program is all about. It's about our future and taking care of our kids. And what better way to take care of them is to ensure that their future is bright and full of promise and full of dreams, really. We were talking about some of the new ideas you've probably seen in the last couple of weeks. There were some investors that announced that they were going to go mine asteroids, and a lot of the reaction from people was like, "Man, those people are crazy." Well, the first ideas that people came up about spaceflight, they got the same reaction. People said, "Oh, you guys are crazy." Actually, Robert Goddard, I mentioned it earlier, Robert Goddard talked about spaceflight, I think in the 30s, about flying in space, and there were many scientists that said, "Well, you know, he doesn't understand that rockets need air to push against." Well, the scientists didn't understand that, no, it's all about momentum, and you don't need that. And we can fly in space. We don't need air to fly, or ether, you know, to fly in space. So what I wanted to do today was to share some mainly pictures from my trip to the International Space Station. I want to make this, you know, open. If anybody has a question, just ask it, and we'll try to answer it right away. I'll try to play a video as well, and for you hardcore Jimmy Buffett fans, if you stick around at the end, I'll actually play a video of when Jimmy Buffett happened to call me when I was on the space station. So hear that. I actually put together a cheeseburger kit for him, and he liked that. Space food. The first challenge of flying in space is designing the patch, because you know you're in an office with a bunch of type A++++ personalities, you know, AKA fighter pilots. Now I wasn't a pilot. I was a navigator. You don't have to be a pilot. You don't have to be a guy to be an astronaut. I was a mission specialist, so my specialty was robotics and going on spacewalks. Now, I happened to be in the military at the time, but you don't have to be in the military either to become an astronaut. But when you're in this office that, you know, there are a fair amount of fighter pilots that will tell you what they think about your patch. And, you know, they'll look at them, they'll go, "Oh, well, the color's all wrong," or what's with this shape, you know, what's with the diamond shape, you know, I like round better, you know. But what somebody told me early on is that any patch with your name on it is a great patch. Because that means, because a lot of people, you know, it's hard to get accepted for the kids in the audience here today, is that whatever you want to do, keep trying, because I started applying to the astronaut program in 1984 and wasn't accepted till 1990. So there were a lot of people telling me no along the way. And I know as a parent, you know, probably the parents here are saying, don't tell my children just to keep persisting like that, you know, and because I'm telling them no for a reason. But in the right cases, you know, it's you want to be persistent and pursue that dream. So keep trying and keep pursuing that dream. So a lot of people, it's hard enough to get selected, and then to get assigned a mission, you know, there's no guarantee that you'll fly in space, but somebody reminded me, hey, if your patch has your name on it, you're good to go. That's all you need. So every patch is designed for every mission, and this happened to be for my space station mission. At the top here, I know a fair amount of people that read Cyrillic letters, so it actually says Onufrienko. Yuri Onufrienko was our commander. Yagavadu Paduski, I had to learn Russian. And Yuri learned English. Carl Waltz was the other American up there with us. And we swap on space station. When I was up there, we only had a crew of three. Now they have a crew of six most of the time. And so Yuri, the commander gets to put their name wherever they want it on the patch. And, you know, lo and behold, it's usually on top. The Russians have their own acronyms. You see there on the lower left-hand side, ISS for International Space Station. On the right-hand side, it's not MKC, it's really MKS for Mezhdu Narodnaya Kosmicheskaya Stantsiya. So, mouthful for International Space Station. But from my experience, when I first entered the Navy, and I went to my first squadron as a navigator, we would go on deployment, we would go across the pond, as we called it, we would go across the pond in the carrier, planning nuclear strikes against the then Soviet Union. Fast forward 17 years, and I'm sitting in a simulator speaking Russian with my Russian commander in a former top secret military training base outside of Moscow. So to me, the most important part of the International Space Station is the international aspect of it. I think it's going to be very difficult for our planet to get, for any humans to get out of low Earth orbit without some type of international cooperation. So I think that's, when we look back, I think in 20 years from now, when we look back, we'll see that the International Space Station was not as much the building of the vehicle itself, but the building of the cooperation and the relationships with our international partners. So there was a crew, I'm looking a little younger there on the left, so this was taken over 10 years ago. So 10 years ago today, I was on Space Station and wondering when I was going to come home. In the middle there is Yuri, on the right there is Carl Waltz. Carl was in the Air Force. He was an Air Force flight test engineer. Notice in this picture, notice how short Yuri's hair is, and later you'll see it grow a little bit. During the mission. Now, lifting off in a space shuttle, I do have a video that I'll show you here shortly, but a lot of times people say, well, what's it like lifting off in a space shuttle? And I say, well, to me, it's like taking off on an aircraft carrier, catapulting off the end of an aircraft carrier. It just lasts a lot longer. It lasts 8.5 minutes of acceleration instead of the 2.5 seconds you get off the carrier. And then people usually say, yeah, Dan, most people know what that feels like, launching off an aircraft carrier, but perhaps I know there's at least one person in this room who knows what that feels like. So I'm going to go ahead and play the video here. It'll be short enough, and hopefully we won't make it too loud for you.
Firing chain is armed, sound suppression water system activated. T-minus 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8. Go for main engine start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Thank you. vehicle in the lower atmosphere.
The solid rocket boosters, there's a lot of vibration associated with those, so it's really hard to read the instruments and rely on the ground to tell us if anything's going wrong.
Atlantis, you are go and throttle up.
Right.
All three engines looking really good, back at full throttle now. At liftoff, the fully fueled shuttle boosters and external tank weighed 4.5 million pounds. It now has burned half of that liftoff weight in propellant.
Yeah, even though we're upside down.
Into the flight, all three auxiliary power units that provide hydraulic power to the orbiter's systems in good shape, as are the fuel cells, providing electricity to all of the systems on board. Atlantis is already 19 miles in altitude, downrange from the Kennedy Space Center, 20 miles traveling 2,500.
Yeah, even though we're upside down, we're feeling at this point probably about 2 G's, so all you feel is mainly acceleration on the back, and you really don't even feel like you're upside down. After Challenger, this was... You know, people were really happy at this point because they thought, well, once the solid rocket booster is away,
confirmed
that the mission will go okay. But we found out after Columbia, that Columbia had a, I'll show you on a picture here real quick. Yeah, during the Columbia launch, if you look in this area right here, I think you can see my cursor there. But this external tank is covered with foam. Think of it like a big thermos bottle. It holds those cryogenic fuels inside. And this big piece of foam right here, it was like a suitcase piece of foam that came off sometime during launch, during Columbia, and impacted the wing right about in this area. And the ground knew that a big chunk of foam had come off and it hit the orbiter, but they didn't know exactly how much damage had been done to Columbia. And as unfortunately, as we all know, when they re-entered, essentially the hot gases came in and essentially took the wing off during re-entry. So, you know, flying in space is a dangerous business, but, you know, I think it's worth doing it with the research that we can do up there and the technology that pushes us to develop, to do things that are hard. This was our family photo. So that was the mission that took me up to a space station. And it was just the three of us on board. A lot of people see this picture and they go, hey, you know, if it's just the three of you, who took the picture? Okay, well, we have remotes up there and we have timers, just like everybody does here on Earth. And then other people say, well, you guys really aren't weightless because look at that advent calendar. How come it's hanging down? We use duct tape. So this would happen to be our family photo. We're wearing our Russian flight suits there. And, you know, this point in time for me, I was missing my family. It happened to be, you know, end of December, and I was really missing my family. But if you recall, this was in 2001, so it wasn't hard for me to think that there was many troops that were overseas at that time, and people were probably getting close to shooting at them, so nobody, at least that I know of, was shooting at us in space. So, you know, I felt pretty, you know, lucky in that aspect. This is looking down at the Kennedy Space Center. You see the two launch pads there right in the middle. Originally, that's where Apollo launched, and then the space shuttle launched from, and then in the near future, other vehicles will launch from there. In the lower left-hand part of the photo, you see a long runway. That's at the Kennedy Space Center, where at the shuttle landing facility, where the shuttle likes to land. And actually, at the end of this mission, my family was waiting for me in Florida, and I landed in California. So, you know, my family was like, well, that's just par for the course. You know, you go away for 6 months, and then you land in the wrong place. We see one of these every 45 minutes, and I don't know whether this is a sunrise or sunset. So we end up going about 17,500 miles an hour, orbit the Earth 16 times a day. It's equivalent to about 5 miles every second. And then every 45 minutes, we may see a sunrise or a sunset. And I remember one time Yuri coming to me, and I guess he felt I was too stressed, and he just kind of took me by the back of my neck and stuck my head in the window and said, "Look at that," you know. And I was like, "Wow, that's beautiful. Okay, now I'll get back to work." You know, he just wanted me to absorb some of the culture up there. This is one of those pictures I need to take out of this presentation. You know, the women are laughing because they're going, "Yeah, this is what guys do when they think they did something really cool. They take the dopey photo." You know, so it's kind of like, you know, we're really cool. It could be hanging the big fish that looks like a minnow, you know, in between us or something. This was after my first spacewalk when I installed that ham radio antenna, and it happened to be in a Russian spacesuit. Now, it looks like just some fancy long underwear, but there's actually thousands of feet of plastic tubing woven inside of that long underwear. And the reason we need to do that is that when you're weightless, when you're up in orbit, and it's kind of difficult to explain, but you know, when people say, "Well, there isn't any gravity in space," that's not right because, well, gravity keeps us in orbit around the planet, but we're going so fast, we're actually falling towards the Earth every second, but we're going so fast, you know, this way, you know, kind of horizontal to it, that we never get any closer. So if you think of it, we're kind of in constant free fall is a better way to explain it. But one of the effects of that is that, you know how you have convection for what they really, the actual term is free convection, but where hot air rises. Well, hot air rises, hot air doesn't rise inside the space station, and also, so we don't get any natural mixing or cooling effects. So to cool our bodies has to be through conduction. So we have these plastic tubing that carries cool water that cools our body, because when we're inside the spacesuit that you'll see here shortly, inside the spacesuit, if I were to start perspiring and the inside of this visor would end up getting, you know, all fogged up, and that's actually an emergency where we'd have to come back inside the vehicle. So the Russian spacesuit is kind of a one-size-fits-all spacesuit. I don't do real well in a one-size-fits-all anything. You know, like a one-size-fits-all mic. But you know, you learn to work with it. Actually, in the back of this suit, the upper part of it, I had about this much room between my back and the back of the suit itself. So during training, the way we train for spacewalks in the Russian suit is the same way we train in the U.S. suit, is we go in a big pool, they add weights to us, and so we don't tend to float up or sink. And one of the times I was training in the Russian suit is I took my arm out of the sleeve and I scratched my nose because I had so much room inside the suit. The trainer's eyes got so big that I decided not to ever do that again. Because one of the protocols that we had is that if you're using Russian hardware, they had to certify you or say it was okay for you to go on a spacewalk. So I really had to play by their rules, and if I was upsetting them, then I would have to un-upset them.
Why did Prohibition use the Russian suit instead of the U.S.?
Yeah, the reason he had, I don't know if everybody heard the question, why use a Russian suit and why not use the U.S. suit? If we were working on the Russian end, the Russian suit has a different way of translating. We have like two different tethers that we use in the Russian suit, whereas the U.S. suit, we tend to keep it's kind of a tether reel that has a wire that's always attached. We can't do that on the Russian segment because they have a lot of things that are sticking up. So that's why we use the Russian suit. And part of it is they want to use their hardware too, and they have different things to use on their end of the space station.
Is that something that changed from flight to flight, or was that kind of a political decision?
No, usually whether there were experiments or things that we had to do, if it was on the Russian end, typically we would use the Russian suit. But incidentally, one of the good things about cooperative program is that after Columbia, see, the U.S. suits weren't really made to go up there and be used multiple, like used for 6 months to a year, and then kind of toss them out. That's what we do with the Russian suits. They're used like six times, and then they basically toss them overboard. With a cooperative program, after Columbia, we didn't have a way to get the U.S. suits up and back, so the Russian suits were the only ones that we could use to do that. Now, there are some pluses and minuses. The Russian suit works at a higher pressure, so we can't, you're not going to go outside the Russian suit and do any detailed work. It's kind of rough work that you would do with the Russian suit. So there's pluses and minuses, but with a cooperative program, you know, even though our suit, you know, after about 6 months to a year, we couldn't use anymore, we could use the Russian suit if we really needed to. This is inside the Soyuz capsule. There's not a whole lot of room inside there, but I was pretty comfortable inside that capsule. So even though the space shuttle took us up to space station, the Soyuz stayed up there after the space shuttle went away. The Soyuz was like our lifeboat when we were up there. So if we had a problem, we could get back quickly. This is a picture of the San Francisco Bay Area with Oakland kind of to the lower center of the picture and San Jose to the left. North is kind of oriented to the right. And if you look closely here, you can see basically here's the San Andreas Fault. So anybody who lives in California, I say don't buy real estate here. And then the next picture we'll zoom in a little bit. And it looks like a black and white photo, and it's not. It's just kind of the sunlight, and the light just kind of blew out the camera and the amount of light. But some of the things you can see, some of the details just from reflections of different reflections of the ocean. There you see the Golden Gate Bridge is right there. This is Alcatraz. Here's the Bay Bridge, Treasure Island there, downtown San Francisco is right there. Here's the Monterey Bay Area where I work at the Naval Postgraduate School is located right about there. This is what they call the Monterey Peninsula right there. Santa Cruz for you surfers is up there. You know, it's kind of funny, all the battles that we sometimes have. I don't know if you heard on the news that Santa Cruz wanted to be called Surf City USA, but then there was some other town in Southern California wanted to be called Surf City USA, and I'm like, boy, the things that people argue about. This is in entrance to the Chesapeake Bay, where you see Norfolk. You can actually see some shipwrecks if you look closely. There's like a V-shaped right here. That's a ship right there with a wake coming away from it. And anybody who's been over the Chesapeake Bay Bridge Tunnel goes right across that way. Storage on space station, there's not a whole lot up there. So it's kind of like storage in California. It's really expensive. So when we're not using the airlock, that what you see there in the background is the airlock. And when we're not using it, that's where we store stuff. That was like our closet. The only problem was before you went on a spacewalk, you had to clear out your closet, you know? And so it's kind of like your garage, you know? Garage gets filled up, and then if you actually want to use it, you have to clean it up. So that's what we ended up doing. And there, so later on in the mission, I ended up doing a spacewalk. And if you look closely, you can see one of Carl's feet there. I sometimes bring a laser pointer with me. Let's see. That's what all these pockets are good for. I think it'll work. Yeah, so if you look closely, there's a Carl's foot right there. We're kind of stuffed into this airlock, and you see his headlights right there that are on. And the reason they do that is that when you go into an airlock, later they're going to close a hatch, and then they're going to suck all the air out. And well, if you're going to waste all this oxygen, you might as well do it in as close of a tight a space as you can. So that's why the engineers made the airlock big, made the airlock small, because if they made it too big, then you'd just be wasting all the air. And everything up there, you kind of have to, you know, conserve the best that you can. This is inside the U.S. lab. If you look really carefully, we try to have a sense of humor with the ground. If you see, there's a blow-up blue alien that we have right there, kind of stuck up there. The writing, you know, this is kind of what I would call right side up in space station, but when you think about it, you could float upside down and just convince yourself that the ceiling is now the floor and the floor is the ceiling. There really is no right side up other than how you read the writing. I'm not really good at reading writing upside down, so I tend to take a picture this way. This happens to be about a 200-pound treadmill. It was a spare part that is just kept up there with bungees. You don't really need the bungees to keep it up there. It's just so that if you went by it and you knocked it, you didn't just start this 200-pound object into motion, because it doesn't have weight per se, but it still has mass. And if that could end up breaking displays and stuff like that, so you have to be careful. Oh, one thing I wanted to say is that if you were really, really good, you could push off kind of the end of space station that you couldn't see and kind of fly like Superman or Superwoman through the hatch and get all the way, almost all the way into the Russian segment there. So, you know, that's people say, well, what did you do for fun up there? Well, you know, we tried to do some things for fun, and that was one of the things, doing our Superman moves. This is robotics. The Canadians built the robot arm on the space station. One of the differences is that we didn't really have a window to look at when I was out there, so we had to do it all with cameras. And believe me, even though we trained a lot in the simulators so that we wouldn't break anything, when you're operating the real arm, it's kind of like you start sweating a lot because a lot of people are watching and you don't want to break anything. This is I believe it's now abandoned copper mine in Ajo, Arizona, but some of the things just that you can see from space, you see this kind of open pit mine. Here's the settling ponds that they have, and the shadowing effect that you get. Sometimes it's, when you look down at the ground, it's hard to tell, well, where are the mountains and where are the valleys, just because of the shadow effects. This is San Diego and Coronado, California. Cities just tend to look kind of gray, maybe just from all the concrete that's up there. This is Coronado. The Navy tends to have some really good bases. Maybe they just need to be by the water. But there's Coronado. I mean, actually, here's Coronado Island, and there's the Naval Air Station on North Island. When we were up there, we happened to be going by Patagonia, the southwestern part of South America, and they want us to get pictures. Normally it's covered with clouds, and they want us to get a lot of pictures of that area. So, but these pictures just were amazing. When you're sitting there taking the pictures, it's just so beautiful. It's hard to describe when you see it in person. It's kind of like the difference between seeing a movie and then seeing a 3D movie in IMAX, and then multiply that by about 100 times of what it really feels like. And so different bodies of water here, it's interesting. This is probably a colder body of water where you see the sharp edge where the glacier comes in, empties into it. And then this is probably a little bit warmer, and it's probably brackish too. It probably has some salt in that water. But you just think of all these glaciers, of everything coming down. And one of the reasons why they wanted to take pictures of it is that, you know, global warming, one of the signs is how these glaciers are growing or receding. I call this glacier art. This is in near Central America, and it looked like a volcano that had erupted perhaps a year before, and then after a season of rains, all the ash ends up choking the rivers that come down from it. It looked like they were having some burning going on. When you're up there long enough, it's interesting. You can get good enough to where you look out the window and you just see, let's say, a flash of color of the terrain, and you can say, oh yeah, that's Central Africa, or that's Australia, just from the colors that you see. This is in Naval Air Station Key West in Florida. Jimmy Buffett hangs out there sometimes.
Now, does your orbit geosynchronous the
time? Say again?
Was your orbit always geosynchronous?
No. We basically, if you think of our orbit, we orbit the Earth, and we would stay at the same angle to the equator. And then essentially our orbit more or less remained fixed with relation to the ship to the sun, and then the Earth rotated underneath us. So if you really wanted to get a good picture of some place, you might have to wait 2 weeks to where it would come around again. I'll have a story about that in a second. One of the challenges of being in the same can, and really this is, I was literally in the same can with two other people for 6.5 months. And when people say, well, what's that like? I say, well, next time you go on a family trip, never get out of the Winnebago or never get out of the minivan. And, you know, certainly we had a little bit more room, but, you know, there's that aspect of, you know, if you have an argument, you know, what do you do about it? You know, it's like, so, you know, there's a few times where we just had to have some friendly discussions. It really is good. I actually think it's almost like for married couples, it's like an encounter weekend, an encounter 6 months in space, you know? You're really going to find out what that other person, what that other person is bugging you, or how you bug that other person, believe me, when you're in those tight quarters. Well, one of the things, every minute of every day almost was kind of controlled up there. And when you're up there, there's kind of this tendency to say, well, I want to dig out my own project. I want to do something for me, but, you know, not to be selfish, but just say, you know, to say I did it and, you know, call it a hobby or something else. So anyways, one of the things I came up with is I said, while I'm up there, I want to take a picture of every place I've been in the Navy. So this is where my career started, and this is at the Naval Academy. The Naval Academy is right there in Annapolis, Maryland. There's a lot of landfill that was where a lot of the playing fields were built. Here's the Severn River, and here's the Chesapeake Bay.
So what you're seeing as you're going on in orbit, the same terrain all the time, or was it varying slightly as an incline in orbit?
No, essentially every orbit was different. Because if you think of it, you know, if you think of our orbit being like a hula hoop, and then the Earth rotating underneath it, you know, so it changed all the time. And at night, one of the pictures, I should have brought it up here tonight, but somebody recently made a video of, you may have seen it, but I think it's like a 2 to 3 minute video of taken from space station. They put together stills, and a lot of those stills are at night, and they're amazing because, you know, half of our time was spent at night, and the lights from the cities, you know, the thunder, the lightning, not thunder, yeah, the lightning from the thunderstorms that you see, let's say, all over the world are just amazing that you can see. It's like an orchestra going on.
Who is going to be asleep and who's going to be awake?
Well, we as a crew, there was the three of us, so essentially when we were asleep, the ground was awake. So the ground had basically three shifts of people that worked 8 hours each shift, and so we would all go to bed as a crew. And so the timing that we went to bed, basically we usually used Greenwich Mean Time. So we'd go to bed about 10 o'clock at night, Greenwich Mean Time, and then we wake up at 6 in the morning. But during that time, you know, we're still going around the Earth, and night and day changes. And that was one of the challenges, because everybody's probably heard of the circadian rhythms that your body has, and those light changes affect when you think it's time to get up and when you think it's time to go to sleep. So we would just try to cover all the windows and make it dark as we could when it was time to go to sleep. But as a crew, with only three people, we all slept at the same time. Anybody guess what we're practicing here? We're actually practicing CPR. It's like being on board ship in the Navy. Every week you had kind of an emergency drill. And one of the emergency drills we had here was practicing CPR. And the way the engineers first designed it, well, first of all, we have to have this table that's insulated from the rest of space station, because if we were to shock somebody, we would shock all of space station. So we needed to insulate the patient, and we actually simulated, Yuri was busy, so we simulated his chest height with rolled up towels, and you got it, duct tape, together. And then I just decided, well, let me see if I can do the chest compressions by pushing off the ceiling. It actually worked. I mean, I was proud of myself that I reached, you know, was able to push off from the ceiling. And then we're kind of simulating the two-person CPR here. And we got out all the medical kits to make sure we knew where they were. That was one of the challenges of being on the space station, because even though you knew something was inside, you didn't know exactly where it was. I mean, how many times has it bugged you? You know something, you misplaced something, and you don't know where it is, but you know it's in the house. Well, multiply that by about like a billion things that are up there in space. We actually had a computer program, and most of the stuff was barcoded, so we would just search, well, where is this widget? And it would tell us, go look in this area, and sure enough, that's where it was most of the time.
A little bit of the crew before you didn't put it back.
Yeah, and that was an issue too. Sometimes people don't put things back where they're supposed to go. So I've been up in orbit about 4 months, and I went to Yuri and I said, Yuri, you know, I really wanted to get a picture of Mount Everest, and I haven't been able to do it. And Yuri goes, don't worry, it will come around again. Yuri had flown, you know, Carl and I were thinking we were pretty cool because we flew 3 times before this mission. Yuri only flew once, but his one mission was on the Russian space station Mir for 6 months. So Yuri had the experience of long duration. He knew, Dan, if you wait long enough, you know, you'll get that picture. Because, you know, remember I described that the Earth would be rotating underneath us and sometimes we wouldn't get the right conditions. And so, you know, there might be no clouds over the Himalayas, but it would be at night, and that doesn't help me to get the picture, so I just had to wait. And sure enough, I was up in the middle of my sleep period. I later found out that the ground knew when Dan got up in the middle of his sleep period and went back to use the bathroom. Not only could they tell when I turned the toilet on and when I turned it off, because they get telemetry and they see the voltage spikes and everything, but they could actually see me translate, because the minute, anytime I kind of translated off the walls or the ceilings, they could see a minor change in the space station's attitude. That's how sensitive the equipment is. So they always knew when Dan was going to the bathroom.
Dan, was there any problem for Yuri to speak English?
His English level was about as good as my Russian level. So, you know, we, on Space Station, we normally spoke Ringlish, kind of a combination of the two. You know, if it was a technical problem that dealt with Russian hardware, we would put, you know, let Yuri get on the radio and talk with a specialist, and then we'd listen in and pick up the highlights, and if we didn't understand something, we'd ask him later, and vice versa, the same thing if it was U.S. hardware, so... But if I was using a Russian suit and going on a Russian spacewalk, it was all Russian. I had to use Russian. That's just kind of the protocol. Same thing.
What did you do to learn the Russian? Did you use one of those tape things they talk now where they ask you?
Yeah, no. We had instructors when I spent about half of my time. So in the 3 years that I came before this mission, I spent about half that time over in Russia learning their systems, and we would have a Russian instructor over there, and then we also took Russian in the States. And, you know, for the kids, the best thing you can do is take a language, because the people who picked up the quickest were the ones that already knew a second language. So, you know, there's something in your brain that triggers. If you know another language, it's much better to learn.
Did you take the language in high school?
Yeah, I took Spanish in high school, but that, you know, I didn't go beyond that. Unfortunately, when I went to the Naval Academy, they had just changed the rule where they didn't require everybody to take a language, which I think is a mistake. I think they've reversed that. But I think it's really a good idea to know another language. So, anyway, so I was up in the middle and looked of my sleep period. So I looked at the laptop and saw that we were going to be going over to the Himalayas. And lucky enough, now you look at this area, you go, well, where's the highest point in that picture? You know, where's the highest point? Now you could probably guess it's probably in the middle of the picture. You know, but what helped me is I knew beforehand if I looked for this V-shaped valley. And then I know that kind of points to the north, it's an upside down V, and then look down the eastern valley, that would kind of lead me to Mount Everest, which is right there. And it's hard to describe. You think, okay, here's this guy flying in space, he has all these responsibilities, you know, he's doing all these spacewalks, all the robotics, and he's excited about taking a picture of Mount Everest, you know? All I can say is that's what living in a can does to you. It was just something that was a challenge that I challenged myself to say, you know, I want to do that. So anybody read the book Into Thin Air? Yeah, amazing, amazing story of, you know, and people say, well, why are we flying humans in space? You know, it's kind of like, why do people climb Mount Everest? You know, it's like, would it be the same thing if somebody, Sir Edmund Hillary just flew over Mount Everest in an airplane and just dropped his flag off of it? You know, I mean, that's the human, that's part of our human adventure, that's human spirit, to go and do these things. We wanted to take a picture and promote reading. What I didn't realize is that, you know, people would look at the books and say, so you know, I think Carl gets the number one award here. He's reading Stephen Ambrose and Wild Blue, but who can tell what's wrong with his book? Yeah, it's backwards. You know, he's looking at the end of it. And now Yuri maybe gets second place because he's reading a book about fishing. It's an atlas of fishing in the Moscow region. Yuri's what's known as a nastoyashiy rybak, which means a real fisherman. We'd be floating over Newfoundland, and Yuri would just, not floating over, but flying by Newfoundland very fast, and Yuri would look out the window, and he would just be saying, can you imagine a fisherman floating over an area that rich with fish and not being able to drop a line? So it was like torture for him. And then myself with Harry Potter, I think I got third place. Or maybe first place. I'll try to wrap it up here in just a couple of minutes. Every so often we had another vehicle come up, and this happened to be a Progress that came up, a Russian cargo vehicle, was unmanned vehicle, came up. And I was really excited because I knew I'd get this package from my family about this big. It was like letters from home. And even though we could email, even though we actually had an IP phone that we could phone home, that it was just something to get, you know, something real that you could touch to know that your family had, you know, made that for you. And so when they opened up the hatch, the first thing that overcame my senses, I smelled these fresh oranges and apples. Now, I'm not going to get into detail of what space station smells like after 4 months with just three guys on board. But, you know, smelling the fresh oranges and apples was amazing. We don't have a refrigerator on board. Most of our food was dehydrated. So getting anything fresh there, and those probably lasted about a week. I mean, we had to hurry up and eat those. But just that smell that we hadn't smelled for such a long time was amazing.
They built the decay slower in space?
No, not really. No, don't do that. Weightlessness doesn't help that part. This is our Aurora Australis, or Southern Lights, and again, this picture doesn't do it justice. It's much more dramatic than that, especially when, and that's the one thing, if you get to see that video, I'll try to find the link tonight and maybe show it tomorrow or give it to Drew or Roy that they can put on the Kopernik website, but it's a real neat clip, and it shows some of the Northern and Southern Lights. Now, this was a Space Shuttle Endeavour coming up to pick us up. That was the crew that replaced us. Peggy Whitson, she just cut her hair really short because she didn't want to trust the two Russians in cutting her hair. She was up there. And now remember I said pay attention to Yuri's hair? Now Yuri cut our hair, and actually the way you have to cut hair up there is in front of like the air intake of a filter. Because if you just cut your hair, it would just kind of float away. So we had to do it in front of this filter. And, you know, I said, Yuri, how come you won't let us cut your hair? And he explained it like, well, I'm in the military, and this is the only time I can get away with not cutting my hair. And, you know, I was thinking, the Russian just doesn't trust the Americans with sharp objects. Well, by the end of the mission, his nickname became Fabio. This was Space Station as we left it. And this was kind of an emotional moment for me because here I am, I'm on the shuttle Endeavour, pulling away, and I look at, and that was my home. It was like my home for the last 6 months, and I really didn't have that perspective on it. So it was really, I mean, even though I was really happy to go home to my family, I mean, that was my home. So when you leave that place, it was just really, it was really odd. It just caught me by surprise. One of the other things I want to show you is look how very thin the atmosphere is. I mean, we're only orbiting the Earth, about 200 miles above the Earth. The Earth's diameter is about 7,000 miles. So we really are just kind of skimming over the surface of the Earth. And what you get an appreciation for is how thin the atmosphere is. It's like a thin shell. And this is a close-up of Space Station before we left it. This was a big segment that was added on during our mission. And this is what Space Station looks like today, without the shuttle attached to it, but it's huge. It's bigger than, basically, the length, the size of, including the solar rays, is larger than a football field.
Were you concerned at all with space junk when you were up there?
Yeah, actually on the outside, his question was about space junk. Were we concerned about that? When we went on spacewalks, especially on radiators like these, when you would go out on a spacewalk, you could see them pockmarketed by little micrometeorites that impacted it. And it was almost like the front of your car, how it gets chips and stuff like that. So there is orbital debris up there, and if we aren't careful, we could make it so we couldn't even leave this planet if we wanted to. I mean, it is becoming a concern. And if you probably read, may have seen in the news a couple times, the space station crews have had to get into their vehicle because they're uncertain if some big piece of space junk is going to hit it. And you'd think after 83 million miles, I would have gotten an upgrade in my seating. I just wanted to fit in that small area to see if I could do it. It felt comfortable. So this is inside the space shuttle before we came home. And there we are landing in California, and my family's in Florida. Right, yeah. The reason we had to land in California is that the weather was bad in Florida, so we had to land in California. So what I want to do now, if we could bring up the lights, I just want to answer any questions that you might have. I know we're getting kind of late for the new ones here, but it is a Friday night, you know. Spring screen. Yes?
What sort of medical gear did you have on board?
Oh, gosh. We had, Carl and I essentially went through what I would call like a crash course, EMT crash course. So we actually learned how to intubate people. I'm not quite sure if those people knew about it, but we went to the Houston Health Science Center, actually Herman Hospital, and we were actually able to intubate people. So we learned how to do that. We basically, you know, we couldn't perform surgery. I mean, we wouldn't be, you know, taking out somebody's appendix or anything like that. If somebody had appendicitis, they'd have to come home. But we had any type of dental, you know, emergency, we were trained to kind of do the first aid with it and take care, stabilize the patient. But, and we did have a defibrillator if we needed to use that. But if something serious happened up there, we'd essentially have to pile into the vehicle and come home.
What was the lead time of something happening? What sort of that help could come to you guys?
We could deorbit probably just about almost every orbit. We had a deorbit opportunity to get in the vehicle. The problem is where that landing area might be. There might not be the best shopping in the area where you would land. As a joke, but I mean, really, we could pretty much.
Would they go by with the U.S. shuttle or a Russian ship?
If the shuttle wasn't docked, remember that the shuttle would just go up there and drop us off, and then it flew away. So when the shuttle wasn't there, all we had was a Soyuz, and then every day the ground would send up deorbit opportunities, basically times that we'd be able to come home. Alex, you have a question? Okay. I'm worried because Alex is going to ask the tough question. Okay.
Well, before we
landed,
we were supposed to go to
it could have been that, or sometimes what happens is that we take these pictures. So I think Alex is saying that oh, there it is. So you see that little faint circle there. What happens is that we're taking these pictures inside on the other side of a piece of glass in the shuttle. And I think what you're seeing is a reflection of maybe the camera or somebody else takes that picture. But good eyes. Boy, good eyes. Wow.
I'm just fascinated with the topic of long range travel, the effects on a human body. I'm just wondering, as far as the atrophy and the like, what you felt like and how long it took to regain your muscle mass. And frankly, as you're getting a little older, can you actually identify some issues that you may be having that you could attribute to your time and space?
Okay, now you're not picking on the grandpa now, are you? I know, I'm just sorry. Yeah, actually, On the average, we lose about 1.5% every month that we're up there in space. So I lost, in my 6-month mission, I lost about 10% of my bone density, mainly in my upper trochanter and my hip. That is one of the concerns for flying to Mars, because a mission to Mars could, one way, could take anywhere from, at the very least a month, and perhaps 6 months to a year to get there. And it'd be a shame to take all this time to get there and then you're not strong enough or your bones are too brittle to be able to walk on the surface. One of the people asked, well, why do you take calcium supplements when you're up there? The reason we don't is that we're more worried about renal stones or kidney stones than we are about, you know, the bone loss. So what they try to do is they try to give us exercises that will maintain our bone density. Some of the ideas that have been thrown out as far as long duration flight is to have some type of, if you remember 2001 Space Odyssey, some type of a rotating structure to where you get even a minute kind of, some type of artificial gravity, so, you know, that could help out. The other challenge of going to Mars is that on space station, you know, we can get home, like I said, just about within a few hours. We're only a few hours from home. When you go to Mars, you might be months away from home. Let's say if you have failure half of the way there, you know, it might be many months before you get home. So many other things come into question. The medical question that was asked, we'd probably have to have a physician on board, because I don't think anybody's going to trust me, you know, even intubating them. So, I mean, you're probably going to have some type of a real doctor on board. You're probably going to have the facilities you have. Some people have said, well, what if you get appendicitis, I mean, when you're up there? Well, the Russians said, oh, we'll solve that. We'll take all of them out, you know, before the astronauts fly. You know, we're like, I'm not sure about that. But there's a lot of things, and these are hard, but they're not so hard that we can't fix it as humans. I think we can figure this out. And that's what the challenge is that having these hard things to do and to figure out a way to do it. The other thing is food. I mean, is there a way that we can grow our own food, much like you've seen in science fiction? And again, I go back to a lot of these ideas, as far-fetched as they seem, you know, just flying in space as we're doing now was science fiction not too many years ago. I mean, so, anyways, did that answer? Oh yeah, I didn't answer that part. Yeah, so when I landed, after like a 10-day mission, I felt bad for like 2 or 3 days, you know, no, 2 or 3 hours, sorry, after like 10 days, and that was sort of my sense of balance. I felt kind of weird and a little queasy in my stomach. After 6.5 months, it took like 2 or 3 days to get used to feeling gravity again, because your inner ear all of a sudden is sending all these signals to your brain that it hadn't for 6 months. And I asked the flight surgeon, I said, well, why do I feel sick to my stomach? It's not like I drank something or ate something bad before I deorbited. And they said, well, it's just like a protective, natural protective mechanism that your body has. If it doesn't understand what's going on, it goes to emergency step number one, which is to empty your stomach. You know, it says it assumes you've ate a bad berry. You know, so our bodies are pretty well engineered. It's kind of like our bodies will try to do things to protect ourselves. And so so it took 2 or 3 days, and I felt pretty normal, and then most of my bone density came back after 6 months, and I didn't do anything real fancy to do that.
Yes. With the privatization of all space now, how do you feel about the dwindling light of NASA, you know, as a whole?
Yeah, one of the, you know, I think that the commercial space it's an attempt to kind of transition. To me, the analogy that I use, it's like when aviation first came about. It was only the military or the barnstormers or the real, you know, dangerous people that were trying aviation. And, you know, you couldn't just go down and get a ticket to fly on an airplane. And then eventually it transitioned to kind of like a commercial business. And I think that's the analogy that I would see with that. I think it's going to